Greetings and welcome to the Cathedral of Mary our Queen. Today we celebrate the solemnity of the body and blood of Christ. A worship aid may be found on our website at cathedralofmary.org. Our presider today is Archbishop William Laurie. Please rise.
Of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. My brothers and sisters, peace be with you.
Spirit.
We gather in joy to celebrate the solemnity of the Lord's body and blood, Corpus Christi, the great gift that Jesus gave, the gift of himself when he instituted the Eucharist on the night before he died. As we enter into this mystery, let us ask for the grace to celebrate it with worthiness and with joy.
Lord Jesus, you raise us to new life. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord Jesus, you forgive us our sins. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord Jesus, you feed us with your body and blood. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to people of good will.
Give you thanks for your great glory.
Let us pray. O God, who in this wonderful sacrament have left us a memorial of your passion, grant us, we pray, so to revere the sacred mysteries of your body and blood, that we may always experience in ourselves the fruits of your redemption, who live and reign with God the Father in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever. Amen.
A reading from the book of Exodus. When Moses came to the people and related all the words and ordinances of the Lord, they all answered with one voice, "We will do everything that the Lord has told us." Moses then wrote down all the words of the Lord, and rising early the next day, he erected at the foot of the mountain an altar and 12 pillars for the tribes of Israel. Then, having sent certain young men of the Israelites to offer holocausts and sacrifice young bulls as peace offerings to the Lord, Moses took half of the blood and put it in large bowls. The other half he splashed on the altar. Taking the book of the covenant, he read it aloud to the people, who answered, "All that the Lord has said, we will heed and do." Then he took the blood and sprinkled it on the people, saying, "This is the blood of the covenant that the Lord has made with you, in accordance with all these words of his." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
A reading from the letter to the Hebrews. Brothers and sisters, when Christ came as high priest of the good things that have come to be, passing through the greater and more perfect tabernacle, not made by hands, that is, not belonging to this creation, he entered once for all into the sanctuary, not with the blood of goats and calves, but with his own blood, thus obtaining eternal redemption. For if the blood of goats and bulls and the sprinkling of a heifer's ashes can sanctify those who are defiled so that their flesh is cleansed, how much more will the blood of Christ, who through the eternal Spirit offered himself unblemished to God, cleanse our consciences from dead works to worship the living God? For this reason, he is mediator of a new covenant. Since a death has taken place for deliverance from transgressions under the first covenant, those who are called may receive the promised eternal inheritance. The word of the Lord. Lo, the angel's food is given to the pilgrim who has striven. See the children's bread from heaven, which on dogs may not be spent. Truth the ancient types fulfilling, Isaac bound, a victim willing, Paschal lamb its lifeblood spilling, manna to the Father's sent. Very bread, good shepherd, tend us, Jesu, of your love befriend us. You refresh us, you defend us, your eternal goodness send us in the land of life to see. You who all things can and know, who on earth such food bestow, grant us with your saints the lowest, where the heavenly feast you show, fellow heirs and guests to be. Amen. Alleluia.
Be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Mark. On the first day of the Feast of Unleavened Bread, when they sacrificed the Passover lamb, Jesus's disciples said to him, "Where do you want us to go and prepare for you to eat the Passover?" He sent out two of his disciples and said to them, "Go into the city, and a man will meet you carrying a jar of water. Follow him. Wherever he enters, say to the master of the house, 'The teacher says, where is my guest room where I may eat the Passover with my disciples?' Then he will show you a large upper room furnished and ready. Make the preparations for us there." The disciples then went off, entered the city, and found it just as he had told them. and they prepared the Passover. While they were eating, he took bread, said the blessing, broke it, gave it to them, and said, "Take it. This is my body." Then he took a cup, gave thanks, and gave it to them, and they all drank from it. He said to them, "This is my blood of the covenant, which will be shed for many. Amen, I say to you, I shall not drink again the fruit of the vine until the day when I drink it new in the kingdom of God." Then, after singing a hymn, they went out to the Mount of Olives. The Gospel of the Lord.
My dear friends in the Lord, as most of you know, the bishops of the Middle Atlantic area, after consultation, decided that the time has come to reinstate the obligation for Catholics to take part in Sunday Mass, effective the weekend of June 26 and 27. We reached this decision in view of the sharply declining COVID positivity rates, and also because we know that many people are anxious to return to church. One parishioner put it this way. He wrote, "Watching you say Mass on TV has been okay, but now it's time for the real thing. I guess you could say, I'm not a candidate for an Emmy." That parishioner is, of course, right on target. There's no substitute for taking part in Mass in person and for actually receiving the body and blood of the Lord in Holy Communion. And many people are more than ready to return to Mass, even as life in general returns to some semblance of normality. Yet there are other Catholics, many Catholics, whose belief in the Eucharist has faded, who even before COVID no longer took part in the celebration of Sunday Mass, and maybe who no longer see the connection between the Eucharist and their lives. And so there's an urgent need for us to unite as a family of faith in bearing witness to the truth and beauty and love of the Eucharistic mystery. An urgent need for us to invite those who no longer practice the faith to consider returning. And so with that in mind, the Archdiocese of Baltimore today launches what we are calling the Year of the Eucharist, a graced opportunity for all of us to revive and to strengthen our Eucharistic faith, to open our hearts anew to the real and living presence of Christ in His Word, in the worshiping assembly, in the priest who offers Holy Mass, and above all, in the bread and wine, which, when consecrated, become the body, blood, soul, and divinity of Christ. What better day to launch the Year of the Eucharist than Corpus Christi, the solemnity of the Lord's body and blood, And so in light of today's scripture readings, let us reflect on the Eucharist. First, as a mystery to be believed. Second, as a mystery to be celebrated. And third, as a mystery to be lived. First, the Eucharist is a mystery to be believed with all of our mind and heart and soul. To understand this, we can turn to our first reading from the book of Exodus. In that reading, we meet up with Moses and the chosen people at the base of Mount Sinai. Moses is preaching to the people. You might say he is conducting a liturgy of the word. He's not merely conveying information, but rather he is bearing witness to all the Lord had told him and to all that the Lord would ask of his people. The core of Moses' message is what we now know as the Ten Commandments, namely, a whole way of life based on love of God and love of neighbor. The book of Exodus also recounts the response of the people to what Moses said. They exclaimed, "All the words which the Lord has spoken, we will do." Well, Sunday after Sunday, something similar takes place in our churches. The scriptures are proclaimed from the Old Testament and the New, especially the gospel. Hearing the message, the word of God, we respond, "Thanks be to God," and "Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ." The homilist is then to explain the readings, but even more so, to give testimony to the faith. And why? So as to open our hearts and prepare them to enter anew into the covenant of love, which was sealed by the blood of Christ, shed for the forgiveness of our sins. The liturgy of the word should stir up our faith and prepare us to enter wholeheartedly into the liturgy of the Eucharist and to receive our Lord in Holy Communion with living faith. Now, belief in the Eucharist leads us to want to share in the celebration of the Eucharist. And so the Eucharist is a mystery to be celebrated. If we wholeheartedly believe that at every Mass we truly partake in the Lord's sacrifice of love on Calvary, that we truly share in the victory of his resurrection and consume his body and blood, then the Eucharist moves from the periphery of our lives to the center. Belief and celebration are joined together inextricably. We also see this point from our first reading from Exodus, where Moses, having proclaimed the word of God, enacts and celebrates the covenant, the marriage bond between God and his people. He does this by splashing the blood of sacrificed animals upon the people as a source of purification and deliverance and as a way of bonding the people of Israel with their God in covenantal love, all of which came with God's promise of ultimate purification and ultimate deliverance. In the gospel, set during the celebration of the Jewish Passover, Jesus, God's Son in the flesh, fulfills God's amazing promises. Sitting at table with his closest followers, The Lord perfected all the animal sacrifices which God's people had offered from of old. He did this by taking bread, blessing it, breaking it, and giving it to his apostles, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body." And also the cup, saying, "This is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many." Jesus gave them bread and wine that was his body and blood, the body he would offer on the cross and the blood he would shed for our redemption. Instead of splashing the blood upon them, he gave himself to them as food and drink. And the Lord still does this every time we gather for the celebration of the Mass. From the start, the church came together to celebrate this wonderful mystery of love. And I would invite anyone who has been absent from Sunday Mass to return and to partake of the Lord's Supper, this wondrous meal of his body and blood, the body and blood which the risen and exalted Lord still offers on our behalf in the halls of heaven. Truly, the Eucharist is the source and summit of our lives as Christians. And finally, the Eucharist is a mystery to be lived. The changing of bread and wine into the body and blood of Christ signals a moral transformation that must be taking place continually in my life and yours. You and I, individually and together, receive the body of Christ so as to become the body of Christ. Each of us must be living and breathing images of Christ, whose life we share so intimately. And together, we must form the body of Christ here in the Archdiocese of Baltimore. This means that you and I must approach the Eucharist certainly with faith, but also with humility and love, with a mind and a heart that is open, with a spirit of repentance, and a resolve to live the love we experience when we receive the body that was broken for us and the blood that was outpoured for our redemption. And let's be clear, you and I often fall short. We sometimes fall into sin, maybe even serious sin. And we all know that sin isn't just a breaking of a rule, but rather in some way a rejection of God's friendship. Sin signals that our hearts, in some way or another, is closed to God's will, and that maybe at times our intentions are not good. How important, then, that you and I prepare to receive and welcome the Lord into our hearts by taking part in the sacrament of reconciliation, frequently and worthily, and that each day you and I examine our consciences to see whether or not we are living the truth and the life and the love we celebrate in the Mass. When there is dissonance between how we worship and how we live, then we give other people a reason to stay away from Mass. But when our lives manifest the self-giving love of the Savior, especially for the poor and vulnerable, then we attract others to the open heart of our Savior, and thus we bear witness by our lives to the goodness of the Lord. So, dear friends, I pray that as the year of the Eucharist unfolds, we will indeed unite as a family of faith around the most holy sacrament of the altar, the Eucharist, a mystery to be believed, a mystery to be celebrated, and yes, a mystery to be lived. And may God bless us and keep us always in his love. Let us now rise, and together let us profess our holy Catholic faith. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us men and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. And by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried and rose again on the third day in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Nourished by the word of God and strengthened by the gift of the Eucharist, we offer our prayers to God, our Heavenly Father, with confidence and trust.
For the Holy Church of God, united as one in the body of Christ, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For God's grace to accompany the Church of Baltimore as we embark on this year of the Eucharist, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those communities around the world that are unable to regularly celebrate the Eucharist, and for an increase of vocations to the priesthood, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the students and teachers of the School of the Cathedral, especially the students who graduated this past Friday, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For peace among the nations and for the just sharing of the earth's fruits, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For an end to the scourge of racism and ethnic hatred, which divides the human family, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those who suffer physical and spiritual hunger, for those without shelter, and those who are alone, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the sick and the dying, especially those around the world suffering in this pandemic, and for all healthcare workers and medical researchers, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those who have died in the peace of Christ, and for those whose faith is known to God alone, that together with Mary our Queen and all the saints, they may find a place at the heavenly banquet, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the prayers that we hold in the silence of our hearts. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer. Heavenly Father, pour forth your Spirit upon us. Deepen our faith in the Eucharist. Help us to celebrate the Eucharist worthily and joyfully. And help us to live the mystery we celebrate. We make this prayer through Christ our Lord.
Please be seated for the preparation of the altar. The ushers will take up the collection at this time. Those joining us via live stream are invited to visit the link displayed on your screen to make an offering. Thank you for your generosity.
Brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God the Almighty Father.
May the Lord, accept the sacrifice at your hands for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and the good of all his holy church.
Grant your church, O Lord, we pray, the gifts of unity and peace, whose signs are to be seen in mystery in the offerings we here present through Christ our Lord. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks. Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. For at the Last Supper with his apostles, establishing for ages to come the saving memorial of the cross, he offered himself to you as the unblemished lamb, the acceptable gift of perfect praise. Nourishing your faithful by this sacred mystery, you make them holy, so that the human race, bounded by one world, may be enlightened by one faith and united by one bond of charity. And so we approach the table of this wondrous sacrament, so that bathed in the sweetness of your grace, we may pass over to the heavenly realities here foreshadowed. Therefore, all creatures of heaven and earth sing a new song in adoration, and we with all the host of angels cry out, and without end we acclaim.
Oh,
You are indeed holy, O Lord, the font of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread, and giving thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith.
When we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim your death, O Lord, until you come again.
Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that, partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world, and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis, our Pope, and me, your unworthy servant, my assistant bishops, and all the clergy. Remember also our brothers and sisters, and all who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Blessed Joseph, her spouse, with the blessed apostles, and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life, and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him and with him and in him, O God Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, forever and ever.
Amen. 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 Amen.
Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, O Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. For the kingdom, the power, the glory are yours. Amen. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you. Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church. Graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
May the peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit. Let us offer each other a sign of peace.
Lamb of God, behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word and my soul shall be. Thank you.
act of spiritual communion. My Jesus, I believe that you are present in the most holy sacrament. I love you above all things, and I desire to receive you into my soul. Since I cannot, at this moment, receive you sacramentally, come at least spiritually into my heart. I embrace you as if you were already there and unite myself wholly to you. Never permit me to be separated from you. Amen.
Let us pray. Grant, O Lord, we pray, that we may delight for all eternity in that share in your divine life which is foreshadowed in the present age by our reception of your precious body and blood. You live and reign forever and ever. And just prior to the final blessing, if I may say a word about the changes occurring in the staffing of the cathedral. As you know, Monsignor Boy shared with you last week that he's completing his service as rector of this cathedral of Mary, our Queen. I just want you to know how grateful I am and how grateful we all should be to Monsignor for his 7 years of devoted service to this cathedral parish and for really fulfilling the heaviest responsibilities in the life of the Archdiocese of Baltimore so well and so effectively for many years. So Monsignor is taking a well-earned sabbatical, and then after that we'll be back for an assignment, and he hopes it won't have quite so much administration to it. As his successor, as most of you know, I have asked Father Louis Bianco, who is my priest secretary, to become the next rector of the Cathedral of Mary, our Queen. Many of you know Father Bianco because you see him here with me, but also because he previously served here as an associate pastor. Normally he'd be with me tonight, but Father Bianco's doing a wedding out in Carroll County. It's an outdoor wedding, and I think by now he's probably covered with cicadas. But he looks forward to serving you, and I know you'll welcome him with all your hearts. I also want to I'll tell him you said so. Also, I want to thank Father Kevin Ewing, who's completing his service as the cathedral. You've come to know him as a wonderful, young, energetic priest with a truly pastoral heart. He is moving on to direct campus ministry at Towson, and I know he will be a wonderful pastor to those young people, and that this ministry that he will conduct will be very fruitful. He's hiding in the shadows, but he knows your great love for him, and thank you. And as his successor, I have asked and appointed Father Justin Goff. Father Justin Goff is a native of the Archdiocese of Baltimore. He is from Bainesville, not too far from here. He is completing his graduate studies in Rome, and really, really looks forward to coming home and working with Father Bianco, Deacon Fritz, and the team here at the cathedral to serve this parish with his heart and soul. So as these changes occur, I know that you will keep everyone involved in them in your prayers and support them with your love. Let's now ask the Lord to bless us. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Blessed be the name of the Lord.
Now and forever.
Our help is in the name of the Lord.
Who made heaven and earth.
May Almighty God bless you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Go in peace, glorifying the Lord by your life.